are forever, Lord of the ages, God before time. We are a vapor, you are eternal, love everlasting, reigning on high. Jesus, Redeemer, mighty to save. You are the love song we'll sing forever, bowing before you, blessing your name.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure. As life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
No matter the mountain, no matter the valley, there's a name above it all. No matter the testing, no matter the breaking, there's a King above it all. And He reigns forevermore.
Good morning to each of you, and thank you for your presence and your support for the Fletcher family and for all of those others involved. Today we'll be doing a lot of singing, and so we want you to raise your voices. I will try to be clear where the songbooks are being found. You will find a purplish book, and I will mention this is Hymns of the Church. The black books, the Christian hymnals, are underneath. And for the first song, if you have a folder, you can find As the Deer. And we will start with that one and sing several songs, and then we will keep on going. So let's make a joyful noise to the Lord this morning. I believe it's towards the back in your folder. As the Deer. I think for sake of ease of singing, if we come to a place where at the end of the line where it says thee, let's sing you. As so my soul longeth after you. Let's just sing it that way this morning. Let's sing As the Deer.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Number 113 in the Hymns of the Church. 113. For the next songs, we will be using this book.
Thank you.
number 6. Song number 6.
Thank you.
877. For the beauty of the earth.
For the beauty.
One more right now. 488. A mighty fortress is our God. 488. And truly, this is our prayer and our confidence.
For still our ancient
Good morning. Can you say that it's a good morning? Sometimes it's harder than other times. I don't know that any of us really want to be here for something like this. And yet, this is part of life. This is part of the way things happen. I'd like to share with you just for a short time here this morning some of my thoughts as as I think about death, as I think about Debbie being gone, as I think about pain that we experience as loved ones, as people who are left behind when someone leaves, a little word that came to my mind, and this is not something that's new just since Debbie passed, but it's something that has been rolling in my head for some time now. A little four-letter word. It's spelled F-E-A-R. Are you familiar with that word? Fear. I don't know that I will ask you to raise your hands, but I could ask you how many of you like that word. How many of you like fear? What is it about fear that we don't like? And as I've thought about that, one of the things that I see in my own experience with fear is how often is it when I feel fear that it's because something is happening to me or to people around me that I can't control. Do you ever think about that? Do those two go together somehow? How much does my lack of ability to control things create that feeling of fear that I feel? And maybe if I flip it around, I can look at it as whenever I feel that feeling of fear, is that an indication that I'm trying to control something that I can't actually? And as I thought of death in particular, because that's right in front of us, it's right in our face, especially right now, what is it about death that brings us up short? Do you feel that way? I feel that way when I face it. Not so much that I think of it that way for myself. I wouldn't say that I would... that I would say that I'm afraid to die. But when I think of death and, you know, what if something happens to someone that I care deeply about? What if something happens? What is it about death that brings up that feeling, for me, brings up that feeling of fear? And I wonder if it isn't a lot that feeling of this is something that hits me in the face, that it is something I absolutely cannot control. I can't do anything about it. You know, even the most skilled, the most knowledgeable doctor out there cannot keep someone alive. They can help, but life and death is not in our hands. (Clears throat) can I learn to use, I don't know if I should share this with you. You know, I felt some fear just to come and stand in front of y'all. Can I learn to use that fear to help me recognize someone who does care and who does have things in his control and who's able to guide my steps? I wanted to share a little story with you. Story is about a young man whose name was Charlie. And Charlie, I believe he was I don't remember the details really clearly of the story, so I'll share them as I remember them because I don't think the details are that critical. Charlie was playing on a high school basketball team, and they had a fairly good team. And I don't remember if it was their last game, but it was an important game that they were playing. And they did fairly well, but they weren't quite in the lead, and the game was almost over. With less than a minute left in the game, the coach called a timeout. They had a huddle, and they planned their strategy. What can we do to give us the best chance at winning the game? And they decided what they were going to do, and part of their strategy was for when they started playing again, in their play, Charlie would end up with the ball to make the final shot. So they took off again. Charlie got the ball, and he was scared to try to make that shot. One of his teammates had an opening, so he passed the ball to his teammate. His teammate, with seconds left, made a shot, hit the rim, bounced off. They lost the game. And after the game, they met, took care of their stuff, and the team members were leaving. And finally, it was only Charlie and the coach left. And before he left, the coach said to Charlie, "I guess you realize that you just cost us that game." But then as he turned to walk away from Charlie, he turned back and he said, "Remember one thing. If you can't trust yourself, trust me." Charlie said, "I realized in that moment the coach had a reason that he wanted me to have the opportunity to make that shot. And he wanted me to do the best that I could in that moment." And it wasn't a moment when he felt criticism for what he had done, but it was a moment when he felt the confidence that the coach had for him as a player on that team. Now, I don't know if it's fair to compare basketball games to life. And yet I think there are some similarities. (Clears throat) We're familiar with the words of Psalm 23. And I'd like for us to think just for a moment about some of those words. Starts out with the picture of a shepherd who's taking care of his flock, who's taking care of those who are under him. One of the pictures that I like about Psalm 23 is that it says that the shepherd gives to those who are in his care, gives to them what they need. Not for the future. He gives to them what they need for the moment that they are in. And as I think of what I started with, when I think of fear, and how do I face life? Do I need to live in fear? I think fear, I don't think I'm unusual to experience fear. And I don't think that you are either if you experience fear. My testimony is, as I learn to follow the one who cares about me, who cares about all of us, it takes time. I'll say that because I experienced that. But as I learn to trust him, I can learn, rather than living like this and trying to control things that I actually can't control, I can learn to live like this. And as I learn to live like that and to follow him and to allow him to be in control of the things that I can't control anyway, I can live with maybe not totally fearless, because I am human after all, and I have those tendencies to try to grab again and try to take control of things. But I can learn to live with less fear. And as I learn that, and as I practice that, as I do that, I think there's a part of that that it becomes a snowball effect. And it builds, and I can live with more freedom. I can live without needing to fear the future, because he gives me what I need for right now. We all experience pain and loss, and in the case, you know, in this situation, we experience it in different ways, because some of us were closer to Debbie than others were, and we feel more keenly the loss. And yet, as we as we go forward, we don't have to face tomorrow yet, because we're here in today. And we can trust that he will give us what we need for today. And when we get to tomorrow, he will give us what we need for tomorrow as well. And then the next day, and then the next day. Because he's that kind of a God. He cares about us that much. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for being our Father and for caring deeply about us. Caring so much about us that you gave everything you had, risking it all to look out for us. We're grateful for that. This morning we're here and we are acknowledging our loss, we're acknowledging our pain, and perhaps we're acknowledging our fear of future and the unknowns that are out ahead of us. Teach us to trust you. Give us the confidence in you that as we take the next step, you'll be there and you'll help us, you'll guide us, you'll give us what we need for the next moment. Bless Carl. Bless his family. And each of us, as we allow you to do your work in our lives, we commit ourselves into your hands because it's a safe place to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
The nice thing about a hymn sing is that you never know what song's coming next. We have six more songs here next. So in your hymns of the church, turn to song number 669. 669, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. While you were learning that, or finding that, I was sitting here and reminded of an experience that I had with Debbie many years ago, and I couldn't put a date to it. I'm getting too old to actually hang dates on things. Years ago, we picked up this songbook and got this songbook here at church, and we didn't know a bunch of songs. So by inspiration of, I'm not sure who all it was, several of us would get together after church Sunday evening, and we started at the beginning and tried to learn all the songs. And Debbie was one of those, as you can imagine. And she was probably one of the more competent ones in learning new songs than some of the rest of us were. Some of us were along for the ride. I think we managed to get to like song number 35, and somehow that experience fizzled out. I'm not sure what happened, but I still would like to continue on with that. But I just was reminded of that experience and was just an enjoyable thing that we did it seemed like a year or so. It might have been around 25 years ago. That was a long time ago, wasn't it? For some of us, it was. 669, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues of
639. 639. I know that my Redeemer liveth.620. Rescue the perishing.
Thank you.
you for helping me. Take your black songbooks, 597. 597, Shall We Gather at the River. We will sing two songs out of this book, and then we will use those song sheets on your benches for the last one. 597. I have found a friend in Jesus. 25. I think in the chorus, some of the men are supposed to put a hallelujah in there. If you know where to put it in there. I have found a friend in Jesus.
All I need to cleanse and make thee free. my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll.
Hallelujah.
He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Or chairs, there should be a stack of songs. The first one, All Things Bright and Beautiful. I'm going to need y'all to sing out really loud on this one. I'm more unfamiliar with this one. Let's just make sure we start with All Things Bright and Beautiful and then sing the verses and then sing the first part again. Is that correct? Thank you.
Thank you.
I really liked that story about the boy that was wanting to pass the ball to someone else. That's how I feel this morning. I think somebody else could make a better shot. But that's not the point this morning. The point is, I was asked to give my best shot, so I'm going to try to make my best shot. I really love the Fletcher family. Y'all are all special to me. There's a few people like your mom. Some of them have went on, and some of them are still here. I know of a few in this room. Few sisters like my sister Debbie was that are encouragers. But one day they'll go on. But God has a plan for each one of y'all here this morning. I don't care who you are. God has a plan. He made you and you're special. Y'all are precious. Every one of y'all. Why don't we pray? I want to pray for you all and pray for myself too. Just ask God to be near to us. Heavenly Father, we just want to come to you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your love, your care, for your mercy, for your grace, for your provision for each one of us to receive you in our hearts that we could have life eternal. Lord, you have more in mind for us than just to smell the roses and see the flowers and see even the beauty of creation and experience the pain and suffering of sin and sorrow. Lord, you have more in mind. You have an eternal plan for each one of us. Lord, I pray that you would help us to believe in you, Lord Jesus, to allow you to do a work in our hearts, to change us into your image, to allow your love to flow through us toward each other the way you have a plan for in eternity. Lord, be merciful to us today. Lead us and guide us and just be near to the family, the friends, each one that has experienced a loss today. Lord, we want to just get on the same page with you and have an eternal purpose and also a vision for what your plan is for us today. Thank you, Lord, what you're going to do. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Deborah K. Martin Fletcher, 64, of Concord, Arkansas, passed away October 4th, 2023, in Batesville, Arkansas. She was born October 5th, 1958, in Wichita, Kansas, to Ezra and Edna Martin. Debbie lived a very full life of nearly 65 years. She spent her early childhood in Kansas, moving to Arkansas in her early teens. Debbie gave her life to the Lord at the age of 12. She married her high school sweetheart at the age of 17 and won her battle with breast cancer at the age of 25. Debbie worked as a nurse and later as a homemaker and a proud teacher of Whipper Hill Homeschool. Debbie never lost her love for learning. earning her bachelor's degree in 2019. She treasured spending time with her children, grandchildren, and deeply loved her church family. Debbie will be dearly missed by all those who knew her. Survivors include her husband, Carl, married May 28, 1976, sons, David and Sarah, John, Chloe, and Benjamin, daughters were Linda, married to Ron, Sarah, married to Christopher, Jenna Faye, and Carrie, 16 grandchildren, one great-grandchild, and two nieces. She was preceded in death by her parents, Ezra and Edna Martin, and one infant son, Nathan. Yeah, the family also wanted me to share an epilogue in memory of Debbie. You know, as I was meditating, thinking of what can I share that could encourage us this morning. You know, we sang a lot of songs. Debbie loved to sing, affected her family with singing. You know, your family can sing because Debbie could sing. You know, I can't remember how good Carl could sing, but I knew Debbie could sing. And, you know, I just always marvel at how a singing mother can have such an influence on the family. You know, I mean, I've seen it with my family. You know, we love to sing, and my sisters love to sing, and they married men that couldn't carry a tune. And Johnny was one of them, and came out of the Amish church, and they didn't sing right. And I'm serious. I mean, now he can sing, but you wouldn't believe how he used to sing. And my sister Elaine married a man that couldn't sing, but he can sing now, and her whole family can sing. You know, Johnny's family can sing, and that's the way Carl's family is. You know, y'all can sing because of your mom. You know, we sang a couple songs, Shall We Gather at the River, and sorry if I get a little preachy here, but you know, we sang about gathering the saints, we're going to gather at the river, and I was just thinking this morning, each one of us are on a journey. You know, we're all on a journey, every one of us, finding our way, and the decisions that we're making are going to affect the future for us. And then we sang, what a friend we have in Jesus. And then all things bright and beautiful. You know, I don't care who you are this morning. You can be a saint. And a saint ain't being a part of Mennonite Church. A saint ain't being a part of the Baptist Church. A saint ain't being a part of some denomination or group. A saint is one who believes in Jesus Christ. And believes that he can give you hope for the future. It's a very simple gospel. People are trying to confuse it. Satan is really deceiving people today, trying to make people think it's very complicated. Got to do this, got to do that, got to do this, got to do that. Believe in Jesus Christ. He will do a work in our hearts to change us into his image. And he takes us right from ground zero. How much worth is a little baby? Can't send them to the bank. Can't send them to go get the mail. They're a lot of work. But they're a baby. And they're precious. They're valuable. They can't do as much as they will be able to do when they grow up. But they're precious. They're valuable. And that's how it is with being a saint. You start being a saint by believing in Jesus and turning away from your sin and wanting hope for the future. That's how you become a saint. That's how you stay a saint, is continuing to believe and continuing to just follow Jesus. Debbie, I'm going to just read some of my thoughts as I was writing them down. Debbie and her enthusiasm and sense of humor made activities fun to do. She loved reading And she really loved doing research. I think she influenced my wife. My wife loves to do research on anything she thinks people are interested in. Debbie loved that. And my wife was influenced by that so much. Different research that Debbie did, and then they dialogued together. She took an interest in those around her. She was a true friend to us. On the journey we were on, almost over 20 years ago, you know, we left in 2003, and you know, most of you kids were still at home, and you know, I think some of the younger ones were just little, and but yet, you know, your mom was an encourager to us. On the journey we were on, we left in 2003, and before that, you know, we were faced with a lot of decisions that we felt like the Lord was clearly bringing into our path. And they were decisions that weren't acceptable in the norm, even here in this church here. We faced quite a bit of opposition, but Debbie and a few others really stood with us and encouraged us and blessed us. That meant so much to me. There were times when we almost caved in, but there were a few that stood by us. And I'm not criticizing the church here. I know that all of y'all are on a journey too. But many times, we don't look past what we see. We don't look into the heart or even ask the questions of how are you feeling? Are you hurting? There's a lot of hurting people around us. There's times when we hurt. There's times when we're strong. When we're strong, let's reach out to the hurting. And it's not how we look. That depends on how we're hurting. But it can affect us. Let's look past. Let's look a little deeper than just what we see. There's a lot of religion. Whether it's Christian, whether it's atheism, whether it's Buddhism, whatever. That's still religion. And a lot of times we can't hardly see past it. But God is real this morning. God loves you. He loves me. God has a purpose for you and for me. And a lot of times we want to pass the ball to the next guy because we know they can do it better than us. What would happen if you do everything for your children? Never pass the ball to your children. You think they'd ever learn? There's times when we have to pass the ball. Even though we can do it better. That's how God does. He can do everything better than we. But what has He done? He's passed the ball to us. Jesus went. He came, lived, gave an example. And then He went and passed the ball to you and I. So let's keep taking the shot. Don't be scared to miss. We're going to miss more than we hit it. Jesus knows. He knows you're going to miss. That's not why He passed the ball to you. He didn't pass the ball for the other guy to miss. He passed the ball for you to miss. But try. Try to hit it. So I'm going to encourage y'all. Okay, well, I'm getting sidetracked here. But Debbie was one of our very dear friends, and the family was our friend. When we were struggling and going through our journey, right here in this community, in the midst of a lot of judgment and criticism, she stood by us as an encourager on a lot of issues, even though the church families gave criticism in areas of financial struggle, homeschooling, family planning, and responded with love and cheerfulness even in the midst of religious opposition from professing Christians. That's what Debbie was doing for us. Having love and good responses have been some of the most valuable treasures that we have gotten from Debbie. In the midst of a lot of criticism, judgment, she kept loving. You know, all of that has affected each one of us. You know, when people criticize and judge us, it affects us. Y'all know that. Everyone in this room is not exempt from that. You have all experienced some of that. We have given that. I've been guilty on the other side of it, of being judgmental and critical. I have. And of that I can repent. But I can't change it, that I've been there. But that's one thing Debbie taught us. You know, today, Debbie is finished. Her life is finished today. I mean, it's gone. But she's living yet. And she's in our memories. A lot of good memories. She didn't do everything perfect. Some of us have experienced also some negativity from her. How are we going to respond to that? How are we going to respond to life? Each one of us are on a journey. We, as a part of the Fletcher family, want to express our gratitude and support for the support that we sense and feel from each and every one of you that are here this morning. As we celebrate the death and life of our sister Debbie. And also I just want to extend to the Fletcher family, to my dear Fletcher family, each one of y'all. Y'all are special to me. And you're very special to God. And He sees your grief and loss. But let's look at it as a victory for Debbie. She has crossed a threshold. Any criticism or any judgment that any of us wants to give her today about her past, we can give. She doesn't have to worry about any of that anymore. She has crossed a threshold. She has met the Savior. Scripture says that to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. And today she is present with the Lord. So let's look at it as a victorious crossing of a threshold. And the rest of us, let's go on. But let's make choices that are going to affect our future in a positive way. And I also just want to say that I feel quite privileged. Even though I wanted to pass the ball to someone else, but I feel very privileged this morning to try to give my shot. And I know there's others in this room that could have made a better shot, but y'all are special to me this morning. But let's also, each one of us, let's make decisions in a positive light and give our best shot. Don't worry about missing. Don't worry about failing. But God has a purpose for each one of y'all. Y'all are special this morning. Lord bless you.
Thank you for that. I told you we were going to sing a lot of songs. Don't say you weren't warned. We have six more for now. The next one is Jesus Lives in your papers here. And I've asked a group of people to come up and help get this one going. Just a little history on this song, so y'all can go ahead and come up while I'm talking about this. Some time ago, Debbie told my wife that she wanted this song sung at her funeral, and it is in our purple books, but Debbie did not like the tune, and she had asked my wife to come up with a different tune. Well, my wife didn't get around to doing it, and one day Debbie, I believe it was January 9th, Debbie was sitting in David's house waiting on her grandchildren, and she seen the piano, and a tune came to her. She sat at the piano and composed this tune. She then gave the tune to Natalie, and Natalie wrote the harmony to it. And this actually happens to be, isn't this the first time this song is sung? This is the first public rendition of this song. Anyway, so it kind of holds some special memories to us. Debbie loved the words, but didn't like the tune. And anyway, so we have a new tune for this song. And please join in and help us, because we're still learning this song ourselves. Jesus lives.
Jesus lives, and so shall I.
Why don't you stand with me and take your hymns of the church and turn to song number 30. We're marching to Zion. Song number 30 in Hymns of the Church. If you need to take a break, that's what happens in services like this. Come we that love the Lord.
Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching.
Zion, we're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, may speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly field, oh, walk the golden streets, or walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let our songs abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground to fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
Thank you. You may be seated. 986 in the hymns of the church. 986. I was thinking about these songs. It's a little bit like life. We have pensive, sad moments. We have joyous moments. It's just this morning we've got it all packed in a relatively short time. I'd love to sing all different types of songs. 986. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus.
Sing the
wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare us a place when we all
get to heaven, what a day of
Thank you.
Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall trace His ways of home,
Two hundred ninety. I stand amazed in the presence.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how He could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How wonderful and mighty.
Take your Christian hymnals, the black books, 123. Christ the Lord is risen today. You know, I'm not sure if this is a song that y'all wanted to sing. Well, let's see if we can sing it. Y'all might have to help me. It's too high. Don't do that.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Sons of men and angels sing, praise your joys and triumphs high. Sing ye heavens and earth replied. Hymns of praise then let us sing, unto Christ our
77. This is our last song before we have the last viewing. 577. One day the trumpet will sound for all of us, and all men will hear.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, its light shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the saints of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called the yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called the yonder, I'll be there.
Thank you. We'll have a word of prayer here in just a moment. While we are doing the viewing, there are two songs in your papers that we would like to sing, Because He Lives and Where We'll Never Grow Old. And so we will sing those while we are filing through. And if you go through, you can stand in the back and sing them, and then the ushers will tell you when you need to depart. But before that, we will have a word of prayer, and we're going to pray for the food. We're going to have a meal here after the burial, so we'll have a prayer for that as well. So why don't we all stand and have a prayer at this time. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you and we stand in your presence amazed that you have looked down on us with pity and you have redeemed us because of your mercy and your grace that we are here today. And we bless your name for that, and help us all to be prepared for that day when the roll is called and when we hear the trumpet sound. And may we all meet together again in the presence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the food that's been prepared. I pray that you would bless that. Thank you for those who have put a lot of work into that.